part two of our RIC training series. One of the things we wanted to do with this video is to do an overview of some of the equipment required for RIC operations. This is a very equipment intensive process, and we want to make sure that you guys have a good understanding of all the specifics on the RIC pack, the rope, as well as the RIC tool bag, which is an addition for us. So, thanks for joining us today. We're going to look at the RIC pack first. Here we go.
My name is Adam Wooden. I'm a lieutenant here at Station 8. Today I'm going to be talking about our RIC Pack 3, our Scott RIC Pack 3. I'm going to briefly cover the whole pack, what each component does inside of here, and then afterwards we'll talk about what our recommendations are for how we're going to use these components to supply the downed firefighter with air. So on this high pressure side, I know it's the high pressure side because it's got the T. When I open that up inside, there's just two main things. There's the cylinder valve that I'm going to use to turn the bottle on, and there's the UAC connection. So this UAC connection, a lot of people will call the hot fill, which essentially that's what it is. When I hook this up to an empty bottle, the downed firefighter's bottle, it'll take about 50 seconds to go from a full bottle here to deliver half of the bottle to the downed firefighter's empty bottle. So roughly just under a minute. I'm going to know that it's complete when I actually compare this remote gauge to the downed firefighter's gauge. So that's what that is used for. Whenever we use the UAC, it's connected for a minute or until the gauges are equalized, and then it's immediately disconnected. If we don't disconnect it, we run the risk of actually breaking some of the components inside here or the SCBA bottle, and we can bleed all of the air from one or the other bottle. So anytime we use the UAC, it gets disconnected. So that's the high pressure side. It's just got the cylinder valve and the UAC. On the exterior of the pack, I have my remote gauge. Is gonna let me know how much air I have in the bottle, obviously. One thing to understand about this is this pack setup doesn't have a vibe alert, but it has a very distinct bell. When I hit about a quarter of a bottle left in here, I'll begin to hear different bell that you won't hear anywhere else. So no vibe alert, just a distinct bell noise. Move up the outside of the pack, I have different pockets here. Typically crews will carry webbing and Raptor shears in these two pockets. On the top of the pack, this is the low pressure side. It's gonna have the ball on it. So when I see the ball, I know that I have the low pressure side. When I open it up, this is gonna have all of my low pressure equipment in it. It's gonna have my mask, my regulator, and my buddy breather connection. One thing to understand about this, I'm sure a lot of you know, is when we use this, it actually works off of the lowest bottle first before it transitions to the higher bottle. So if there's still air left in the downed firefighter's bottle, I connect them to this, they're gonna finish breathing down their bottle before it actually switches over to this bottle. So essentially, if you use any of the components on this side, you're giving the downed firefighter a full bottle of air. Some of the drawbacks, obviously, if you use any of the components on this side, is they're now connected to the RIC pack, and we'll expand on that later. Several years ago, we actually kind of set these RIC packs up different. The decision was made to set the RIC pack up with everything connected in it, and that was to prepare us for the worst case scenario, is that you're going to find a firefighter that pulled their mask or their regulator. So the decision was made 3 or 4 years ago to actually connect everything in the RIC pack. Throughout watching a number of RIC academies and RIC training ourselves, we found that we can actually set this pack up in a better way to make us more efficient. The main thing being is that we're actually going to disconnect this buddy breather connection. When we disconnect this, it does two main things. Basically, it allows us to turn this bottle on outside. We no longer have to worry about this regulator, which is easily activated. We no longer have to worry about this regulator getting activated while we're bringing it into the structure, because this is no longer connected. So if we leave that connected, we can turn this bottle on outside. It also allows us to not have to hook this this RIC pack up to the downed firefighter if we find them in a certain way. So as we deploy as a RIC team, we can turn our bottle on, we get to the downed firefighter. Statistically speaking, again, we're going to find the firefighter that's pulled a regulator or pulled their mask. But very rarely is a firefighter going to pull their SCBA off completely, which means their regulator or their mask is still accessible for us to use. So if we use the down firefighter's mask or regulator, put that back on their face to secure their airway, and go down here and hot fill, we basically take a minute to fill up their pack, compare gauges, make sure that they're equalized, and then we can disconnect this firefighter, the down firefighter, from the RIC pack. So it actually, it makes us quicker when it comes to supplying air to the down firefighter, and we no longer have to worry about losing air through this regulator.
I'm so scared in case I fall off my chair, and I'm wondering how I'll get down the stairs. Clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right.
The engineer typically is going to be in control of this bag, and it's the last person in the door is typically the engineer. We'll have this, so the person that's the fourth firefighter inside the building is going to be deploying this bag out. It's going to be draped over their shoulder with this seatbelt harness. It's over the shoulder or over both shoulders, kind of across the chest. It has the seatbelt harness here so that you can just hit this and actually pull it off of you. As this bag gets deployed, it has different markings on it. So at 20 feet, I should hit a knot and then a ring, just like this. So this first knot tells me that I'm 20 feet into the structure and that I'm heading towards the fire. So one thing we always got to remember is ring of fire. Ring is always towards the fire. That way when I'm coming back out, I know if I hit the ring and then a knot, I'm going the right way to the exterior. So ring is always towards the fire, and then the knots always tell you how far into the structure you are. So these are marked every 20 feet, so I know I'm 20 feet into the structure once I've hit that first knot. As I continue to deploy it, I'll hit two knots and a ring. This lets me know that I'm 40 feet into the structure and that the fire is still that way. It'll continue in that order up until I get to 100 feet, at which point at 120 feet, I'll just run into one knot and one ring. And that'll let me know that I'm 120 feet into the structure. So the knots will continue to add up to 100 feet. And then at 100 feet, it starts over with just one knot. So like I said earlier, the engineer is the person that usually manages the RIC rope. Once we get to the down firefighter, it's very important that the engineer understands that they have to tie this rope off. So once they get to wherever they're going to the down firefighter, the engineer needs to tie a secure knot that cannot be pulled, and it needs to be secure for a main reason. So when we're heading out of the structure, this rope should be tight on both ways. There shouldn't be any slack in the rope. That way when we package the down firefighter and I'm leading out, I can actually put some tension on this rope and follow it. I don't have to basically run any of this rope through my hand or have it get knotted up on the ground or anything. So it's tied on both sides. As I'm going out, I'm somewhat pulling on the rope. If we need to bring another RIC team in, they're going to be coming in the other way, and they're also going to be pulling on this rope. If they're coming in and they pull on this rope and it lets loose, we no longer have a way to find the down firefighter or the RIC team that's already inside. So this knot needs to be, it needs to be anchored exterior on something that's not going to be moving, and it also needs to be tied to an anchor on the down firefighter side that's not going to move, so it can be pulled in both directions.
Okay, I want to thank you guys for joining us today with our RIC equipment video. Our next video is going to cover a lot more ground. We're going to talk about all the RIC team positions, including the responsibilities for each member. We're also going to talk about how to manage a down firefighter, securing the harness, and all the considerations for air management.
Clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right, here I am, stuck in the middle with you. Yes, I'm stuck in the